I was just about to fix it. Your head's a little chopped off.
Service begins on the inside of the front cover of the bulletin. We gather this day to honor the Lord of Life and to remember his servant, Lillian Friedrich. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us together. He comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. Amen. St. Paul writes in Romans 6, when we were baptized into Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Again, a responsive opening prayer. Eternal God, you are the maker of heaven and earth. You formed us from the dust of the earth, and by your breath gave us life. Jesus Christ, you are the resurrection and the life. You suffered death for all humanity and rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life. Holy Spirit, you are the author and giver of life. You comfort all who sorrow and offer sure confidence and everlasting hope. To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace, O God of eternal glory, We remember before you this day our sister in the faith, Lillian. Lord, we thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of Lillian and all your saints. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. I have a number of scripture passages that I hope and I always find healing, and wanted to share them with you at this time. We begin with two readings from the Old Testament, first from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He guideth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. There's actually three readings from the psalm. The second one I put on her birthday card June, a year and a half ago. From Psalm 91, those who love me, I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. With long life, I will satisfy them and show them my salvation. And from Psalm 116, what shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I shall lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I shall pay my vows to the Lord. Oh, may it be in the presence of all his people, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his godly ones. And then from the New Testament, three lessons. From 1 John chapter 3, one of the readings we had yesterday, and the next one also, this is one of the readings yesterday from All Saints Sunday. We remembered Mom in the prayers of church, lit a candle for her, and remembered her along with other members of our church who passed away this year. And the disciple John, in his first letter, writes this: see how great a love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. And such we are. For this reason, the world does not know us, because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet appeared as what we will be, but we know that when he appears, we will be like him, because we will see him just as he is. The next reading I chose because I thought of all the challenges of life. She and Carl lost a child early on, and then she lost Carl when she was 56, 35 years of marriage. And all the challenges of being then a parent raising and caring for a family and the home that they had made. I like the picture that is in the birthday card from last year, the smile. She never really was defeated by the challenges of life. She rose up and overcame. So I thought of this passage from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the surpassing greatness of the power will be of God and not from ourselves. For we are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. We are perplexed, but not despairing. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. We are struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the dying of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus might also be manifested in our body. For we who live are constantly being delivered over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. And then a second reading from yesterday's service of All Saints Sunday, from Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 through 17. St. John is, the Apostle John has this vision of heaven, and as he looks, behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes and with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, saying, salvation belongs to our God and who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing round the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, amen, blessing, glory, wisdom, and thanksgiving, and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. And then one of the elders addressed me, saying, who are these clothed in white robes? And from where have they come? I said to him, sir, you know. And he said to me, these are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd. He will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. I didn't check ahead of time, but we had talked, and if anyone would like to share something at this point about Mom, Grandma, don't need to, but I left the space for that.
She would appreciate my crooked glasses that I'm just forever smashing her glasses. So these are awful. But I guess COVID stinks, but the only upside is having this intimate group that knew her well, and we don't need to bring people into the fold and let her get to know her. We all know her really well. So I think what I wanted to say was going to be different. I thought about it for years, and it was going to be a pre-COVID thing. And now a lot of what I wanted to say, I don't need to say. Everybody knew her. But you all know she was independent and strong-willed, and she was able to keep up home and her car and her body and everything alone for so many years. I mean, just, it's unheard of. Willpower. She swam her laps at the spa every day. She maintained lifelong friendships with people, co-workers, and her bridge group and her lunch group. She had several plans every week of people that she met with for lunch and stuff. And just thought that was so so important, because it's hard to do that as we get older. And she broke her hand or wrist. We couldn't remember roller skating at a roller skating party. Did she fall with you or me? We kind of have false memories, and I was trying to think of some of the things, and a lot of this, what I was going to say today, my brother probably more than anybody will kind of relate to. She cut her grass with her scissors when she needed to, and she couldn't mow her lawn. Her lawn was immaculate. She just was out there, don't get out there. And she's out there cutting her grass. But my mom and I don't agree on stuff. And this is, when we pass away, there's stuff to deal with. And my mom and I disagree on how important stuff is. Is it, do we need the stuff? Should we get rid of the stuff? I can't look at people at the same time. What does it mean to have things in the tangible or mind as people? And as this last week went by, all I kept thinking about was her stuff and things and so many memories of related to little things about her. And that was funny for me because I'm usually like, stuff doesn't matter. And my brother and I used to wait for her to come with her junk bag. She said she had a bag of junk, and we'd wait for her car to show up, and she'd have her bags of junk. In her car, she always had those squishy mint candies. Do you remember those?
Green leaves.
What were they called?
The green leaves.
The green leaves, yeah. She always had a bag of candy in her car.
Some candy. Always.
She always had a funny new car seat cover of it, so she tried to elevate her seat.
The Lazy Susan. She had a Lazy Susan.
Yeah, it's fun.
So she could get in and out of the car. Like, it's fun. She had little wood beads. Remember the one that had, like, little...
Massaging, yeah.
You know, the massaging. Goofy things that she had that I remember so vividly, all of those things about her, and I don't know why, like those are, the contents of her car keeps coming back to me, which, then thinking about her house, and every room of that house, I know, and you probably do too, like, it was just, when she would come sleep over my house, our house, she slept in this little cot next to my bed, and we would chat and giggle, and we had I had that special time with her that nobody else had. She stayed in my room. And she always had next to the bed her tea, her watch, and a flat Pepsi that we usually ended up knocking over at some point. But she always had like flat soda for some reason, or her glass of wine. But it was usually flat pot for whatever reason. And then in the mornings she would heat up coffee from the day before. And I remember as I got older, trying to tell her, "Man, life's short. Drink a fresh cup of coffee." And she wouldn't. She would just scald this already like covered in grass.
Scalding is the word.
Scalding. And she would scald. Yeah. This is perfectly good. And
2 minutes in the microwave.
Yeah. She would just, you couldn't even touch the cup. But she would drink this old coffee. And I never understood why. And it drove me crazy when I was older. I'm like, gosh, why wouldn't you make a fresh cup of coffee? But that was just her. And she would fry up pizza and skillet. I've never seen anybody frying everything she did, so I remember the sound of that, just pouring and eating an old piece of pizza. It's still good, or an old piece of pork chop she would cut up. And
Slungali.
Was it gulag, or what was
Slungali.
It? Slungali. Slungali, which I think
just
is
leftover
stuff frying in a pan with peppers or something. So, so things like that.
That's even a word.
Is it a word? Yeah.
I didn't know if it's a word.
And then she said she had rocked up. Because you ate the whatever.
Drank old coffee and ate some gallbladder. Turns out it was her gallbladder.
It was her gallbladder, yeah. But Jeff and I, it's in her house, the things in her home were just stuff again, but she always kept jelly beans and like the most beautiful little crystal bowls next to her favorite chair. She had all of her scrapbooks there. The sliding patio furniture, the big metal. Things on the porch that everybody remembers. My kids, I'm trying to think if anybody was there. I have pictures I found of Joshua there, so I don't know if he would have remembered that stuff. But I guess the contents of her home, which stuff doesn't usually matter to me. I don't know if a lot of you kind of felt that way too, but that was just one of the things I wanted to, I don't know. It was just the only thing I could think of. I didn't have to explain her to you guys, and I wasn't even gonna try. Like, there weren't gonna be words to make it happen. So I just wanted to kind of let everybody know, let her know that I remember all those little things. And they were tangible things, but they were her things. And she was so purposeful with everything in her life. She didn't waste things. So if it was in her home, it was beloved. And if she brought it to you, it was because she loved you, and, you know, I think that always made an impact. I guess I never, it was never lost on me, even as a kid. The junk bag was just junk, and she said, I got junk bag, and then her house, she had junk drawers. But they weren't junk, it wasn't junk. She called everything junk, but it was junk that she saved specifically for us. Whether it was jacks or crayons or something, it was, we used to love, I don't know, at least I did, going through her junk drawers and stuff. So, Nancy and I were talking about her basements, how she painted those walls. Probably every year, the cellar walls.
Dry locked.
The dry locked her walls and her floor.
The AstroTurf. The AstroTurf floor.
She had an AstroTurf floor, and I couldn't remember if that was a false memory either, but I'm pretty sure she had turf on her basement.
And the spaceship that Brian and Jason.
We did have a spaceship on her basement. We had switches and, but yeah, she slowed that, and then my brother and I were afraid of upstairs, but she, if you survive the walk up these tiled, steep, probably not to code steps, there was a whole upstairs of other things to explore, and where she tied her rope around her waist into the bedpost.
Nancy her gutters. Nancy found her.
Oh, you. What did she do? She
to do her windows, right?
To do her windows.
She tied her
outside. Like she would tie it around her waist and then tie it to one of the bedposts up in that loft area.
Well, she was sitting on the roof, leaning over, painting. And I called your mother, and your mother said to your grandmother, she was not going to allow this anymore, and she would keep her grandchildren away from her if she didn't listen.
It's the only thing that really mattered.
Yes, we
did.
We know
we all expected a traumatic death, not a 100
years ago. Yeah, it was, yeah.
We've prepared for this day for 40 years.
Wait.
We've prepared for this day for 40 years.
Yeah, it was going to be a phone call, so it was a little, it wasn't as glamorous a way to go out, I guess, but it was her way. She made us all wait years and years and years, which was wonderful. And so weird, I've had a grandmother about like 49 years, and for my son who's 20 to have known her is amazing. And it's just, she was 80, and they always called her slow grandma. Because she moved slower, that was just the name that they had for her. So they still call her Slow Grandma. They just always have. And so I know this is like a babbling thing. There was supposed to be a point, and it was supposed to be about stuff and the meaning of stuff. But it's just, those are what hit me this week when I thought of her. Were just all of these little details about her. So
thank you.
You're welcome. And then Lila, do you want to read your thing? I have a friend.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, I just a few days before we found out that she passed, actually on my Instagram feed, this quote popped up like from a post, and I don't know, maybe Grandma wanted to, or Jesus maybe wanted to join Instagram or something to give it to me, but from Isaiah 57, it says, "Good people pass away, the godly often die before their time, but no one seems to care or wonder why. No one seems to understand that God is protecting them from evil to come. For those who follow godly paths will rest in peace when they die." And I know that was just comforting, and yeah, it helped and let us know that she was safe and everything.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You want out? Well done. Well, two promises about the eternal life that come from Jesus, from John chapter 11. First, in John 11, Jesus comes to the town of Bethany where his good friends live, and one of them, the brother Lazarus, has died. As he approaches town, Mary stays in the house, but Martha runs out to see him, and at verse 21, she comes up to him and says, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." It makes sense, he would feel it. "Even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother shall rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last
day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? And she said to him, yes, Lord. I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, even he who comes into the world. And then during the Last Supper, after the meal, before heading off to the Mount of Olives, Jesus prepares the disciples for what is coming. And he says, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way where I am going. Thomas, the disciple, said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How could we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Here ends our scripture readings. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Well, I'm blessed and pleased to be with you today to celebrate Lillian's life. I've known her for now about 30 years. And have many memories of her. Perhaps the clearest picture of her is of her broad smile. Always welcome, welcoming, always gracious, always pleasant, always serving. I can picture her in church, but I picture her more often down in the kitchen, serving meals with the women, funeral lunches or church meals, potlucks. She was always down there. She was a gracious woman and cared deeply about people. I shared a story at her 100th birthday. I actually brought a picture of it here today. I can show you later. But one day down in the kitchen, she remembered from some earlier time the story of how my wife and I met, when I broke my wife's window with a snowball. And she said she had seen something in an advertisement from the Hummel shop, the Hummel gift shop, that had a mitten with a snowball in it. And she is an ornament, like a Christmas ornament. And she said, Pastor Bob, you have got to go get that Christmas ornament for your wife. Well, I went down to the Hummel gift shop and I got a mitten ornament with a snowball on it. And it doesn't come out at Christmas time. That sits out all the time at our house. And so I see it periodically as I walk past the place where that memory of when I first met my wife, which became a thing that she remembered, and now I have a thing to remember Lillian, and that. But just as she had that memory and that care to say, oh, I saw something I think you'd like, Pastor Bob, and it would be fun. And you know, it's a Christmas ornament, and it wasn't Hummel from Germany, it was just an ornament, it was cheap. She had all these ways of being a blessing in people's lives. And I cherish those gracious, loving actions from Lillian. She was a person who rose to challenges, to suffer the loss of a child, early on their first child. We've not done that, but we've lost several grandchildren who didn't quite make it to being born. And one day we look forward to being with them. But one day, or now already, she, in the promise of eternal life, she's already in heaven with all those gathered around the throne. And she first child. And what a blessing for her, but what a difficult path, and then to lose her husband. And not just that she rose to the occasion, but she was so industrious, so independent. I remember the time talking to her about the girls, concerned about her being on the roof. And I think it was down in the kitchen again. I don't know. We had a lot of our conversations down there. But she said, I just don't think I ought to stay in my house. We talked about that for a few years. Finally, I don't even remember how it is you got them to convert or come and live with her. But I remember the stories of her out on the roof, bending over to clean the gutters, and how independent and strong she was. And she stayed in that house until she was 92. Just amazing. Doing things she shouldn't be doing. But doing all sorts of things that she could do because she thought, I can do this. And so she'd cut up the carpet and get new carpeting laid. She tore it out. She'd redo the woodwork, stripping it and restaining and varnishing it.
Several times.
She would unroll. You could buy roofing material in rolls, and she did some of her roof and garage and porch in the back with the rolled paper that she would unroll and tar into place. She would of course do the normal things of painting, but she patched her driveway, she patched her basement wall. There was almost nothing that Lillian was not ready to try. I guess you'd call that gumption. She was just
graced.
What's that?
My little Grace.
Ah, very good. Well, she was also a woman of deep faith. It started young in life. She was raised in the Lutheran Church. I think she began at Martin Luther, eventually went to Grace, and eventually came to Good Hope, which was near their home on Indianola. And always involved, whether as a child or as an adult, active in Bible studies, active in the women's groups, active in serving. Her faith just caused her to share, to be present, and to share her love with others. She loved nature. She loved good challenges. She kept her mind active. She played chess. She played bridge. She also played fun games with the kids, ping pong and card games and different things. We celebrate the gift of this woman who rose above the challenges of life. In fact, as Paul says, we may be afflicted, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not despairing. Persecuted, but not forsaken. At times struck down, but not destroyed. She was this woman of faith as well, and her faith was a significant part of her life. I like the pictures of the promises of God's word that he gives to those who are faithful from Psalm 91. I will answer them, I will deliver them, I will rescue them, I will honor them. And with long life will I satisfy them. From Psalm 116, the passage I chose ended with the words, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his godly ones. Well, it's a time of sorrow for us, but for God it's a time of preciousness. He's bringing them home, which is what Jesus talked about in John 14. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again, and I will receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Precious is the sight of the Lord is the death of his godly ones. He honors them, he loves them, and he knows that for them, they may be leaving us, but they're coming to him. And he is filled with joy when they die and they go to be with him. The psalmist in Psalm 23 says it so well. Around our life, whether he leads us beside still waters or green pastures, or whether we're in dark valleys or surrounded by enemies, we fear no evil, for you are with me. God is with us in this life. And the psalmist summarizes these thoughts in the last verse by saying, surely goodness and mercy follow me all the days of my life. The Hebrew word for follow, a really interesting word. It's not like my shadow that follows me just because it has to, or a puppy that follows somebody. But the word follow is actually used for hunters. It's used for pursuing game. And so it's not just that goodness and mercy just kind of tag along my whole life. No, God's goodness and mercy pursue me. He's out to pour his blessing of goodness and mercy on your life, all the days of your life. And then when this life is over, we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Through this life, his goodness and mercy is pursuing us, tracking us down. And at the end of this life, he'll take us to be home forever. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Why is this possible? Because God has made the decision about us. It's the overall theme of Scripture. Whether it's in the New Testament or the Old Testament, it's always about God's decisions. Not that we earn God's favor, but that he cleanses us. We heard the word in Revelation chapter 7 of those standing before the throne in white robes, and the elder came to John and said, "Who are these in white robes?" And he said, "Lord, you know, sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." That's the story. We're forgiven because of the blood of Jesus Christ. The only reason we have a hope of heaven is not because we deserve it or earn it, but because God has forgiven us. He chose us, and he chose us as in 1 John to be his children. New Testament, Old Testament, it's the same way. The commandments aren't about what we have to do. Exodus 20 begins with God saying, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods," the first man, and then the whole list. But he begins by saying, "I choose you. I am your God. And I've already saved you." He had. He brought him out of Egypt already. The same is true for us. God so loved the world that he gave his only son. He decided to send his son. Jesus decided to die. Our hope is found in the God of love, in Christ who died for us, to wash us of our sins. What a blessing. When we go to heaven, we're promised so many wonderful things in Revelation. We will stand before the throne of God, and he will shelter us with his presence. You'll hunger no more, thirst no more. And the Lamb will be our shepherd. He will guide us to the springs of living water, and he will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Amen. I printed in the bulletin the words of the Apostles' Creed, if we can share her faith and our faith together, as together we confess our faith in the Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, in our baptism, you knit us together as your chosen people into one communion of saints. Lord, give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. Thank you for the promise of our Lord Jesus, who said, "All those who believe in him shall live even if they die, with the hope of eternal life, and that everyone who lives and believes in you will never die." And so, Lord, we believe that in Lillian's last breath here, she she took another we did not see in heaven with you. That she moved from this life into the eternal life that you promised to give and for which she longed. Lord, we pray that we give you thanks for that eternal life that Lillian has entered. And as she is reunited with her parents, William and Anna, her husband Carl, her little daughter Susan, and all whom she loved. We give you thanks, Lord, and pray that you would give courage and faith to Susan and Linda and their spouses and families, to the grandchildren Meredith and Jeff, Brian and Jason and their families, including the great-grandchildren, Joshua and Caleb, Ethan, Lila, Grace, and Tardy. Lord, we pray that you give courage and faith to all who grieve the loss, the death of Lillian. Give them assurance, certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have the strength for the days ahead. As Jesus said to the disciples, Lord, help them to trust in you and in your promise of eternal life. Lord, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. Help us, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to continue to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. And we pray together the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now our commendation prayer for Lillian. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Lillian Rose Friedrich. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Thank you for fulfilling your promise and receiving her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.